greetings. Those who submit to Muhammad try and claim that Ishmael was the actual child Abraham offered for sacrifice. I was shocked years ago to find this part of Islam's rewrite of history. One of the best ways to prove or disprove a claim is simply to examine it. To understand this, we need to consider, what does Islam hope to achieve with this claim? It is actually to replace the Jewish people. God made his covenant with Abraham through Isaac. Genesis 17:19. But God said, "No, but Sarah your wife will bear a son, and you shall call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him." This is the word of God which Moses revealed in the Torah. And this is the text Islam claims has been changed by Jews. So let us imagine, for the sake of argument, it was Ishmael. Let us imagine and consider and examine the implications of Islam's claim. According to Islam, the text of Genesis 17:19 is a fraud. If it existed at all, it must have referred to Hagar and not Sarah, because God naming Sarah proves the child must be Isaac. So for Islam's claim to be true, this must have referred to Hagar. And if Hagar was the original woman mentioned, the first word ascribed to Yahweh God is incoherent. But God said, "No." It is incoherent because of the context, which we must always respect. Chapter 17, verse 18. And Abraham said to God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." We see that Abraham was clearly begging for Ishmael to have God's attention. And Abraham said to God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." But God said, "No." I know that God says more, but for the moment realize this is an exchange. We are attempting to probe the extent of the change necessary to support Islam's claim. I think what we must realize is that Islam's claim requires a near total rewrite and corruption of God's word. Let's go back a few more verses and understand the context of this exchange between God and Abraham. Genesis 17:15. Then God said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name." So Yahweh God is talking about Sarah, even to the point of changing her name. Now, Islam's claim does ultimately require this having been changed, because it is the context of the next verse. "I will bless her, and indeed I will give you a son by her. Then I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her." Yahweh God says her, and the context proves God is talking about Sarah. Islam's claim does require this having been changed. It must ignore God making this promise to Sarah. "I will bless her, and indeed I will give you a son by her. Then I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her." These promises of God require Sarah to give birth. Sarah is barren and has gone through menopause. Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said in his heart, "Will a child be born to a man 100 years old? And will Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child?" Islam must simply deny this whole exchange happened. Why would Abraham laugh at God if this promise were about a young and fertile, nubile Egyptian named Hagar? And Abraham said to God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." Okay, God, stop pulling this old man's leg and teasing him with an unbelievable, impossible fantasy. Okay, God, I already have a son named Ishmael. He is 13 years old. Isn't it good enough that you just bless Ishmael? So Abraham said to God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." But God said, "No. No, but Sarah, your wife, will bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him." It is this clear, coherent conversation that Islam says is a fabrication and a lie by corrupt men. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. According to the actual text, God is not ignorant that Ishmael exists. And God has a secondary promise to offer for Ishmael. "Behold, I will bless him, and will make him fruitful, and will multiply him exceedingly. He shall become the father of 12 princes, and I will make him a great nation." Now, Islam's claim would force us to believe Jewish scribes created this, well, Islam must call it a lie. But Islam cannot offer any evidence what alleged original text might have looked like. So Islam's claim must demand that you believe Jews made this up in an effort to mask over their sin. The thing I find fascinating by Islam's claim is that this whole text must have been changed. God's mention of the mother of the promised son must have been changed. All the words are simply untrustworthy and must be ignored. Well, except for this very last verse, which Islam will try to claim proves Ishmael has the covenant. "As for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I will bless him, and will make him fruitful, and will multiply him exceedingly. He shall become the father of 12 princes, and I will make him a great nation." And Islam's claim demands that you ignore the very next verse, which must be a corrupted fabrication. "But my covenant I will establish with Isaac, whom Sarah will bear to you at this season next year." When he finished talking with him, God went up from Abraham. At this point, Sarah is not even pregnant, according to the text. If she gives birth in a year, do the maths. Now, keep that in mind and recall the claim by Islam. God made none of these promises to Abraham, to Sarah, of a child born to barren Sarah. But that is a little hard to swallow, given the existence of Israel and all the Jewish people from Isaac to Einstein to Netanyahu. You see, if Sarah, a 96-year-old barren woman, who no longer had her monthly period, if that were an invention and a fraudulent story, no Jews would exist. Islam's claim demands the story of Genesis and the Jews we now read is a lie. So how then do we account for the miracle by God that a barren old woman gives birth? The only possible answer by Islam is nonsense. Allah just did it. Allah barrens whom he will and impregnates whom he will. I suppose one other claim might be that Isaac and all the Jews simply are not real. The Jews were never real, just a fiction written by some Christian author. And exterminating every Jew on earth would go a long way in the direction of supporting Islam's potential rationale, like Islam is doing, and eliminating every trace and Jewish artifact from the Temple Mount would go along with supporting Islam's claim, like Islam is doing, and denying every trace of Jewish historical presence in Jerusalem and Israel would go along with supporting Islam's claim, like Islam is doing. Those who obey the claims of Islam are at least consistent. Those committed to defend the lies of Islam are willing to exterminate the Jews and human civilization to make their lie believable. But for now, the Jewish people and the Jewish nation and the Jewish history exist. So then, how do we account for the miracle by God that a barren old woman gives birth? How do we account for Israel being a nation in spite of 1.2 billion followers of Islam seeking to exterminate them? Yahweh, their God, defends them. But the claim of Islam is that the God of Abraham made covenant with Ishmael. Is there anything we see that evidences this? Some might postulate the oil under the kingdom of darkness of Saudi Arabia. But those taught by Islam were ignorant to obtain it for 1,300 years. And how might Islam answer the new, vast discoveries of oil under Israel's control? If the oil wealth of the kingdom of darkness of Saudi Arabia is God's blessing, the oil wealth under the apple of God's eye, the nation of Israel, must also be God's blessing. In fact, is there anything which we can observe over 2,000 years of history which would lead us to suspect Ishmael's descendants are favored by Almighty God compared to Isaac's descendants? I must answer no when I consider the message of the prophets. Roughly 40 prophets were sent by God to the nation of Israel, according to the Bible. While Islam claims only one prophet and alleged messenger was sent last to the descendants of Ishmael. The constant flow of messengers from God indicates who had God's covenant and God's attention. The number of prophets is 40 to zero, because only in Islam's claims is Muhammad a messenger from a deity. Do I think Islam's claim of Ishmael being the child of sacrifice and covenant is even possible? Not when God has so clearly demonstrated who he has made promise to, who God has shown favor on. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.